Today is the last on our little series of the five marks of mission, where we've been having a wee look to see just what are God's priorities and to see maybe how far we've moved away from the priorities that God has. I was saying on Sunday that the focus today is on the whole topic of justice. And when I was putting the services together for this week, I tried to pick hymns or songs that have that same theme. And while, yes, there are some, there are not nearly as many as we have on other themes. And the ones that there are, many of them are totally unfamiliar to us. It just shows that we don't seem to have that as our focus as often as we do other things, this whole issue of justice. So we're going to start today singing Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, the God who makes justice a priority. So let's talk to God. Let us pray. Loving God, we come to you this morning knowing that you are a great and mighty God. But more than that, knowing that you are love, that your whole being and character is one of love, that you pour out your love and your blessing upon us. Lord, forgive us when we get so wrapped up in our own doings of the day that we totally ignore your presence. When we totally ignore your blessing, giving everyone else the credit. When we don't realize that you have your hand upon us and we fail to involve you in our lives. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. And we ask that you would help us to make your priorities our priorities. For this is your world. And this world will be a better place when your priorities are established as normal and everyday routines for each and every one of us. Lord, help us to love more. Help us to show more compassion. Help us to forgive quicker. Help us to show your love to those around us. And while we're here today, Lord, we ask that you would make your presence known to us, that you would speak to us again. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to read from Micah, the book of Micah today. Micah is one of the Old Testament prophets, and it's a very well-known little passage from Micah, even though we don't spend a lot of time reading all of the words of the prophets. This little bit in particular is quite well-known. It's only 8 verses, and it says this: Listen to the Lord's case against Israel. Arise, O Lord, and present your case. Let the mountains and hills hear what you say. You mountains, you everlasting foundations of the earth, listen to the Lord's case. The Lord has a case against his people. He's going to bring an accusation against Israel. The Lord says, My people, what have I done to you? How have I been a burden to you? Answer me. I brought you out of Egypt. I rescued you from slavery. I sent Moses, Aaron, and Miriam to lead you. My people, remember what the king of Balak of Moab planned to do to you and how Balaam, son of Beor, answered him. Remember the things that happened on the way from the camp at Acacia to Gilgal. Remember these things and you will realize what I did in order to save you. What shall I bring to the Lord, the God of heaven, when I come to worship him? Shall I bring the best calves to burn as offerings to him? Will the Lord be pleased if I bring him thousands of sheep or endless streams of olive oil? Shall I offer him my firstborn child to pay for my sins? No, the Lord has told us what is good. What he requires of us is this: to do what is just, to show constant love, and to live in humble fellowship with our God. Amen. We're going to sing again. Lovely little song. May the God of hope go with us every day. And feel free to remain seated if you want to. We all of us seem to develop a sense of what is fair from quite a young age. Many a time you will see a child having a strop when it sees another child getting something that they're not getting. And we have to explain to them from a young age about fairness, about what's right, what's wrong. And we grow up with that sense of what's right and wrong and what is fair and what's not fair. And you would have had to have been living on the moon if you hadn't been aware of the outrage within our own country at the whole Partygate thing, where we were all obeying rules of COVID lockdown and others were blatantly flouting the rules. And it was that sense of injustice. This isn't right. This isn't fair. And we all felt it, even though some felt it more than others when they had loved ones in hospital that they couldn't go to visit, when people were dying and their loved ones couldn't be at their side. So even those of us who didn't have to go through that process still felt enraged at the injustice of what was going on. But it has to be said that the injustice that the prophet Micah was talking about was the awful oppression and poverty that he saw among his own people. He was a prophet that lived, and I've got dates on there, when I'm saying lived, operated on, we know that he was around and speaking out, round about 690 BC. So we're talking about 700 years or so before Jesus was born, round about the time frame that Isaiah was on the go as well. And he's looking at the way that the rich seem to be getting richer and the poor seem to be getting poorer and they're being exploited and they're not being treated fairly. And he feels enraged by the whole system. And he's speaking out on behalf of God to his own people. And if we had read through a little bit more, which we haven't had time to do today, we would realize that even the people that were meant to be the religious leaders, keeping people right, that corruption was so bad that they would take bribes to give a prophecy in a particular way. That's how bad the corruption was. And what he was saying was, you know, on the outside, you're pretending to be godly, religious people, but on the inside, you're just corrupt. And you're not living God's way at all. And he's seeing this oppression being played out in front of him. And that's why he's saying God is bringing an accusation against you, his people. Why are you completely turning away from God and doing your own thing? And what makes it worse is that these religious people, the religious elite, if you liked to misuse scripture in such a way as they would imply that they were who they were and they were rich because God was blessing them. And if you weren't like that, then God was punishing you, or maybe punishing you because of something that your ancestors had done way, way back in the day. And when we hear Micah speaking out, we have to realize that when Micah does this, he's at risk of his own life. But he brings this message from God. The God who loves us has a great sense of justice. But we always need to understand that God's justice operates differently from ours. He's a God of love and a God of justice. But I always think of it even in a different way. It's because he's a God of love that he's a God of justice. Because when he sees injustice, it hurts him to see the way that we are treating one another. And remember, when you think of all of the things that Jesus taught us about God and all of those parables that he tells us, things about the lost sheep and the shepherd looking out for one, you know, going way beyond the kind of thing that we would normally do. That's the kind of God that we're talking about. So God's justice always operates through a lens of love and a willingness to forgive and a willingness to show mercy and a willingness to show grace and a willingness to bless. And if that's God's priority, he wants us to make it ours. And that's what this passage is about. The passage is about the fact that God's people, that their priorities have now gone totally away from what his priorities were. That's why he's kind of saying, you know, what have I done wrong? Why are you now living that way instead of living the way that I asked you to live? And what he does is he reminds them of the blessings of the past. And we can all fall into the trap, especially when times are hard, of praying to God, and then we start to remind him of things that he's done in the past. You know, Lord, I know fine that you can heal people because you've healed people before. Or I know fine that you can do this because you've done it before, so why aren't you doing it for me? And we fall into that trap of we're reminding God who he is. Instead of us realizing in actual fact, this is who God is. And he wants us to have his priorities as well. When we think of every generation, we have seen terrible injustice in some way, shape, or form. And we don't have to look abroad. We see it in our own country. We've had the scandal of the post office inquiries. And you know what we need to realize is that when you see injustice, it always seems to go hand in hand with poverty. And that might be poverty as far as being poor, or it might be poverty as being emotionally poor. These poor people not only lost their livelihoods, some of them were put in prison. All of their possessions were taken off of them as this post office wanted the money that they hadn't even taken. They lost their reputations. Some of them lost their families. And some of them lost their health, pushed to the brink of suicide through all of the worry and concern. A massive injustice. And the fact that it's taken 10 years to try and sort it all out is an even bigger injustice. And we can all feel anger at that. And it's good and right that we do, because God wants us to speak up when we see injustice, but he wants us to go further and make sure that any dealings that we have with other people are fair, that we are not unfair towards others, that we aren't objects of injustice, but that we watch our own lives and try to help the lives of others. We see it even with the refugees that come in and the way that people can treat them. These are people that have got nothing, that had a country probably that they loved as much as we love ours. And they end up here, penniless. All they want is a life, to be able to work, to be able to be free, to be able to bring their children up in a safe environment. And how many times people tut and say horrible things. I remember some years ago, and it is some years ago now, in Glasgow, some people were out complaining because why are they being given these nice flats and why are they being given nice furniture? And I thought, they've got nothing. Why do they have to live in a slum? They've got nothing. Why can't we show God's love and compassion and grace? And that might happen we might have the opportunity to be able to show that kind of love and compassion and grace to others, because that is one of God's priorities. In that passage that we read, there's a great statement of how we should live. A statement of the fact that God doesn't want empty ritual. And that's what the sacrificial system was. Okay, if I make a sacrifice to God, that'll appease him, that'll keep him happy, and I've got a clean slate and I can go off and muddy it up again. That's not what God wants. He's wanting a life change whereby we make his priorities our priorities and our world becomes a better place. So the answer to that question, what does God require of us? There's that lovely, lovely verse that came right at the end. The Lord has told us what is good. What he requires of us is this: to do what is just, to show constant love, and to live in humble fellowship with our God. It doesn't seem like an awful lot. It's not as if he's asking us to do something that's beyond us. And yet it's amazing how quickly we can forget and judge other people instead of trying to understand their situation. To do what is just, to show constant love, see how closely they run together, and to live in humble fellowship with our God. Let us pray. Loving Lord, we thank you for your word, because your word teaches and instructs us. But more than that, it can touch our very lives. And we look at your word not as some kind of lifestyle magazine, not of something that gives us some kind of information about how we could live better and longer. But we look at your word as something that speaks to our innermost being, that gives us a greater understanding of who you are, that gives us a greater understanding of your priorities and in turn what our priorities must be. Forgive us, Lord, when justice hasn't really been a high priority for us. And today we pray for those who live with injustice. And we pray about the poverty, the emotional poverty. We pray about the anxiety and the burden that they have to carry, no matter what their circumstances. Lord, we pray about all of these people who were wrongly accused of fraud. We pray too, Lord, that there are many today who are wrongly accused, and that sense of injustice must be a heavy, heavy load for them to bear. Lord, we pray for those that are in that situation, that you would carry that load, that you would enable justice to be done. Lord, we pray across the nations where we see corrupt regimes operating in the same way as they operated all those thousands of years ago. Generation after generation living with corruption and injustice. And Lord, help us to make a difference. We may only be small in number. We may only live in a little town, in a little place. And yet, Lord, you are a great and mighty God. And as we wake up and operate as your people, we can make a difference. We know this, Lord, because your word reminds us that you have done it before. Help us to be able to make this world a better place for others to live. And Lord, we take a few moments of silence just now where we bring before you our personal prayers. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for all that you have done in the past and all that you are doing now and in the future. And we make these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close by singing another lovely hymn, "The Voice of God Goes Out to All the World." So now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you evermore. Amen.